Good afternoon, everybody. Thanks to Comea for the invitation. I hope I will say a few words about Greek shipping that some of you may already know, but some of you may not know. Talking about the world fleet, this is how the world fleet has developed over the past over the past 25 years. We have seen a peak of 10% increase in the year 2010, a peak that destroyed the freight market, and we are now back in 2023 to a more reasonable number of about 3%. In January 23, the world fleet consisted of 105,000 vessels of 100 gross tonnage and above, and about 65,000 of those vessels are ocean-going vessels. The rest are short sea shipping ships. This is showing the world fleet ownership in terms of countries' ownership. As you can see, Greece is number one, followed by China. And these are the 2022 numbers. Unfortunately for Greece, fortunately for China, about 2 months ago, the Chinese fleet overpassed the Greek fleet in terms of gross tonnage. In terms of dead weight, the Greek fleet is still number one, and the reason for this is that the size of the ships that the Greeks are operating is much larger than the size of the ships that the Chinese are operating. Are we positive about the future of shipping? Yes, we are. We talk about sustainability. I could say that irrespective of what we do with greenhouse gases, as you may know, shipping is producing about 3% of the greenhouse gases worldwide, but they are transporting more than 90%, Professor Lee, not 80%, as you said yesterday, of the world transportation. The projections for year 2050, if you can see, is that the population will increase a lot. Today the population is 7.5 billion people. By 2050 they say it will overpass the number of 10 billion. And these are United Nations numbers. United Nations they are not doing a good work, it seems, for the Gaza problem, but they are doing quite a good work in terms of projection for the future of the planet. So, Africa will, the population will increase by 70%, they say. Oceania, Australia, which is today a very low population, about 25 million, it will increase by 27%. Poor countries like the European countries, the population may shrink, and this is something that we do see today. GDP growth numbers, Asia and Pacific, and these are the 2023 numbers projected for 2023. Asia and Pacific is leading the world economy. Africa is coming in terms of growth, not in terms of total numbers. And world statistics for seaborne trade, we see a moderate growth for the next 4 to 5 years of the order of 2 plus percent. This, coupled with the fleet growth that we saw before, which is about 3%, and the age of the world fleet may help towards a healthy market. The world share of Greek fleet, starting from the low numbers, you can see that for containers, for example, the Greek fleet portion is about 6%, but if we talk about tankers, the Greek portion is about 25%. For the LNGs, which are ships of the fashion of the day, the Greek fleet is about 20% of the existing fleet. I have to note that The first Greek LNG vessels were delivered to my previous company in 2005. So in less than 20 years, the Greek fleet now is representing about 20% of the world LNG market, and it's still expanding. Despite the fact that LNG vessels have become, I could say, unreasonably expensive, and LNG is a closed, it's a kind of a club. It's not easy to enter the LNG market. Greek fleet evolution. Last year, until March, it was the first year during which the Greek fleet contracted. We lost about 30 ships and about 6 million tons deadweight. What should we be careful about? We don't know what the new technology will end up. So Greeks are not very willing to invest. They don't know if they should invest in the current ship design, larger vessels, what kind of fuel is going to be used. And this is why, in my view, they are restricting investment, despite the fact that one of the good things about the Greek shipping is that they don't need, of course they get financing, but they have their own cash reserves and they can invest without waiting to get a loan from a bank first, to get approval from a bank. The Greeks still believe that there are shipping cycles, and today we are maybe at the top of a cycle, and they expect that the market may come down again, the new building market. I don't know if this is correct, because today major yards, and I'm not talking about the Brazilian yards, they are booked until the beginning of 2028. And if you look at the order book, you will see that the order book for conventional ships, like bulk carriers and tankers, it's at a very low level these years. It's below 5%. Ships live for about 20 years, so it is reasonable to expect that the annual orders should be of the order of 5%. And today we have the next 4 years with only 4-5% of orders, and the shipyards more or less fully booked. So unless we see the Chinese yards to expand again, I don't believe that the capacity will be there to build the ships that we need. The cost of new ships with new technology will go up. If we talk about a VLCC, the price for a VLCC today, forget if it is in China or Korea, is about 115 million. To make it dual fuel, you will need 20 million more. And there are not many people that will do will accept this investment, especially in today's unstable energy market. OPEX will go up, but of course OPEX are not that important today. The OPEX of a VLCC is about $10,000 per day, and the high that a VLCC should get to break even with today's prices is $50,000+ per day. So to economize $1,000, if you can get a charter of 50, it's not really worth doing. EU ETS, I believe you know what will happen in the EU. Ships that go to the EU from next year will have to pay a carbon trading tax. And if we talk about Greek ship owners, they get really sick if they hear the word tax. They don't like this word. Greek shipping, fortunately, and this is one of the reasons of growth, is basically tax-free, as it is the shipping for many other countries. Germany was complaining a lot that Greeks do not pay tax. Greeks pay two times the tax that the German ships registered in other countries, not in Germany, as is the norm, pay. Interest rates, this is a problem. Interest rates, as you know, they go up. Part of the reason of the expansion of the world fleet over the past 10 years was that interest rates were very low. Now we see interest rates of the order of, if you want to borrow some money, it's LIBOR plus 3%, 4%, total maybe around 6%. And the trend is to go for the interest rates to go up. The Greeks do not operate long term, or at least most of them. They prefer to operate in the spot market, take advantage of the spot market instead of doing a long term investment with a reasonable or unreasonable return. This is the exception for this rule is the LNG fleet. LNG is long term employment, is positive cash flow, and this is one of the reasons that the Greeks have expanded in the LNG fleet. In Greece, today we have about a bit less than 700 companies. Only 20 of those companies are above 100 ships, and the total 50 above 50 ships. So the model of the Greek family model, family companies that are operating 5 to 10 to 15 ship today because of the new requirements, because of the complexity of shipping, because of the difficulty of shipping is a bit under revision. But if we lose the small companies, I think the core of Greek shipping will be lost. Many Greek companies have been operating over than 100 years, but over the past 20 years we have seen quite a few of traditional companies pocketing the money that they had made in shipping and investing in other sectors. Cash reserves are being put aside today. And as I said before, there are not many long-time charter fixtures done by Greeks. In 2022, the number of vessels that were sold by Greeks overpaced the number of vessels that were bought. And this is why we see the reduction of the Greek fleet by about 30 ships. Geopolitical uncertainty is an issue. If you read the newspapers, I'm sure that you will read that the Greeks, by going around the sanctions, they have made a lot of money. This is partly true. But on the other hand, political instability, medium term, is not helping shipping. Now, the traditional Greek model. A lot of people are saying that whatever the first generation is doing, the second generation keeps, and the third generation destroys this. And we have seen this in Greek shipping. Maybe not the third generation, but the fourth generation. Analysis of the Greek fleet per type of vessel. As I said before, bulk carriers are dominating. It's 50%, almost 50%. Of the Greek shipping is in bulk carriers and 35% in tankers. Age analysis. A lot of you may have the opinion that, you know, the Greeks, they buy the old ships, they operate them in a substandard way, and this is how the fleet has grown. This is not true. The average age of the Greek fleet today is 13.2 years. The average fleet of the average age of the world fleet is 17.2. There is a difference, or let's say deviation, between what is happening with the Greek control fleet, and up to now I'm referring to the Greek control fleet, and to the Greek flagged, to the national flag ships. Out of the 4,200 vessels that are operated by Greeks, only 500 today are Greek flag. And this may create an issue as far as the operation of the Marine Academies is concerned. If there is no flag, most probably we will lose the Greek officers. And if we lose the Greek officers, that traditionally, as I said before, according to the Greek family model, if we lose them, most probably we lose part of the active Greek shipping today. Class societies that Greeks are using, if you can see ABS, BV, Class NK, and Lloyd's Register, they have about 700 ships or a bit more each. DNV is a bit down. RINA is more down, but RINA is expanding a lot over the past few years. And the next, on the right-hand side, you can see what is happening with the Greek flag vessels. For the Greek flag vessels, ABS has the majority. Main registries, I said before, that the Greek flag vessels is small. It's about 12.1% of the fleet. Liberia is first. Actually, if you study the history of Liberia, you will see that after the end of the Second World War, it was actually Liberia that cooperated with the Greeks and developed the Greek fleet. And Marshall Islands are going up. It's 26% up. I don't know if you know it, but I read it recently, and it's not related to shipping. I read about a week ago that Marshall Islands are still getting money from the US government because of the nuclear tests that were done there 60 years ago. But it was good business, it seems. Environmental equipment. The average percentage of the world fleet that is fitted with scrubbers is 31%. The average percentage for the Greek fleet is 41%. The average percentage of energy-saving devices for the world fleet is about 25%. It's 31% for the Greek fleet. The Greek order book today, it's pretty high. If we talk about LNGs, it's about 15% of the total orders. The company that is expanding in a very high pace today is MOL. I wish them good luck. You can see that for tankers, again, which is the leading, let's say, sector of the Greek fleet, is 33% of the world orders are for Greeks. Talked about new technology. This is a list of the fleets that the Greek ships that are on order today with alternative fuels. It's about 43 ships, which is a high percentage if we compare with other flags. Greek shipbuilding in Korea, it has gone down from a peak of 135 ships in 2010 to 62 ships today, but you have to keep in your mind that the capacity of the Korean shipyards have been reduced. Some people say by 40%, other people say 30%, but definitely it has been a reduction. And also the type of ships that are being built today are much more man-hour intensive. I mean, to build an LNG vessel, you need about 900,000 man-hours. To build a VLCC, you need much less. It's about 450, if I'm not mistaken. As you can see, since 2010, Greeks have ordered 100 VLCCs from Korean yards, and they have also, which is impressive, 124 LNG ships. So what is Korea offering to the Greek owners? There are advanced ship designs, despite the fact that today the trend is you have to order a sister ship. If it is not a sister ship to an existing design, we are not very happy. But in any case, I believe the ships that are being built in Korea are far more advanced than the ships Japan is building today. And I have to say that in my view, and this is from my recent experience with Chinese yards, the Chinese yards are catching up fast. Over the past years, the Korean yards, they have built a variety of ships. Today, they say if it's not a VLCC, if it is not an LNG, if it is not a big container ship, we don't like it. This has to be changed, and I believe it will change. The Korean pricing is competitive, has always been competitive. I don't believe that, let's say, a ship owner will ask to get the same price from Korea and China. I did a study when I was in Maran. Over a 10-year period, the operating cost of Capesize vessels, six of them built in Korea, six of them built in China. The Korean vessels were about $600 per day, less expensive to maintain. And they also spent less time in dry dock. Dry dock is one every 5 years, so it may not be important, but if the market is booming, every day is important. On time delivery until the end of last year, I don't know what is happening today, I'm a bit worried. We see yards requesting late delivery, and we are receiving a number of force majeure notices. Today the temperature is very high, this is force majeure. Tomorrow is raining, this is force majeure. But this is life. Customer relationships are important. I believe the Korean yards, they value, they respect their clients. But on the other hand, the clients should also respect the yards. I'm very much against shipping companies that they order two ships here, two ships in another yard, two ships in Vietnam, two ships in what I don't know where. It's important to have a relationship with one yard, or maybe two. After sale service, we have our problems, but the situation overall is improving. Now, technology is changing. The technology did not change for, as far as fuel is concerned, for the past, since the coal disappeared, we had heavy fuel, heavy fuel, heavy fuel, heavy fuel. Now we will have a number of different technologies. Do we have the time to learn the new technologies? I don't believe so. And this is why, although in the beginning I was against let's say the initiative of Korean yards to set up worldwide service stations. Now I believe that we will need them. The leader in this sector is Hyundai Global Services, but Hanwha Power Systems are now moving behind Hyundai Global Services. I believe it is services that we'll need, but again, the objective is not to make money only, and if you don't make money, the company will disappear in a few years, as happened with DSME recently. But these companies, these worldwide service companies, they should offer prompt service and respect the ship owners, the clients. Apart from these services, and I don't know if there are any other similar organizations, I don't believe so, we have Comea. Comea is representing a large number of companies. Communications with a lot of these companies, if you try to do it direct, is difficult. So this is part of the gap that Comea should fill in. And talking now about Greece. In Greece, we have a similar organization with Comea. It's called Hemexpo. And in this page, you can see the products that Hemexpo, the Greek industrial companies, are producing. In my view, there should be no competition between Comea and Hemexpo. Both organizations should try to cooperate. This is what Hemexpo is today, but this is not important for Korea. I think your numbers are much, 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 much higher. Thank you very much.